Good afternoon. My name is Karen Smithman, and I am honored to be the host of today's ceremony. Welcome to the Western Michigan University Thomas M. Cooley Law School graduation ceremony for the Stanley Matthews class. Today, we will graduate our Juris Doctor candidates. To begin the ceremony today, we ask you to stand for the invocation, which will be pronounced by Adjunct Professor Caroline Johnson, followed by our national anthem.
Please join me in accordance with your personal faith and beliefs to go thanks and reflect to and to offer intentions to the new graduates of Cooley Law School. As we gather today to celebrate the accomplishments of these bright men and women, we give thanks for the many family members, friends, classmates, faculty, and countless others who provided support, guidance, and encouragement to our graduates as they traveled through their law school journey. We are thankful that our graduates have been called to the legal profession where they can use their minds, hearts, and talents to help others. While today is one marked for celebration, we also ask for your guidance in blessing these warriors. Help them understand that because they have already overcome so many obstacles, that they will be able to overcome many more obstacles in the future and stay the course in their journey towards a more just society. Help them to stay calm and when surrounded by interesting people and circumstances. Help them to find a legal practice that allows their passions to come alive so that practicing law never feels like work. Help them remember how critical the judicial branch is to the effective course of justice. Let them become leaders who carry the lantern through the storm for the most vulnerable citizens amongst us. Help them to be kind to all affected parties as they win their cases. September 11th is a day that reminds us of the serious issues that we have faced in our past, that we are facing today, and we will face in the future. Help us remember the images of those Americans on that day putting aside their differences and making every sacrifice they could in order to help each other. Help us to remember those wonderful individuals that we lost and rely on their strength and sacrifices to be strong in their memory in order to uphold the sanctity of the American institutions that help lawyers seek justice. We hope that we will honor those lost souls by clinging tightly to one another and working out our differences instead of looking to condemn each other. There will be tears on the trail of human history, but we must always persist and remember the pain and the joy of the great Americans who tarried before us to bring us to a better day. As attorneys, we are problem solvers and we are the resolution makers, and we must put aside our own natural competitive instincts and instead use our education to lead others out of the darkness by holding their hands and providing comfort in their darkest hours. And wherever these graduates' journeys take them, may the memory of the love and intentions we share with them today sustain them, guide them, and remind them that they are skilled and gifted stewards of the legal profession. God give them the strength to do your work and change the world. Amen.
Thank you, Professor Johnson. Here to sing our national anthem is WMU Cooley student Kimberly Lewis.
What so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the bombs
Thank you very much, Kimberly. You may be seated. The valedictory will be presented by Talise Hunter, who was selected by the Tampa Bay graduates of the Stanley Matthews class to present the class's farewell comments.
Good afternoon, family, friends, faculty, staff, administration, parents, children, significant others, mentors, employers, and those who have departed this earth. Thank you for your continued love, support, and money during a unique law school experience. Fellow graduates, I am proud of us. Thank you for supporting each other. The strong support that we gave each other through one of the biggest challenges in our lives is what kept us going. Through papers, presentations, midterms, finals, burnouts, and even up and until this very second, got us sitting here in these very seats. We have all made this unique law school experience better from the first day of learning IRAC to the very last final. IRAC. Who remembers the first time we heard IRAC? We had no clue that IRAC stood for Issue, Rule, Analysis, Conclusion. We had to train our brains to think and write in this legal manner. It was not the easiest task, but look at us now. We can write briefs, oral arguments, and compliance programs, and make sound legal arguments. I can even apply IRAC to this speech. Now let's talk about issues, because there was no shortage of issues during our law school experience. We probably had the most unique law school experience in law school history. We directly or indirectly survived COVID, depression, racism, and social, political, and economic injustice. We survived the U.S. Capitol takeover, highly contested elections, natural disasters, and building collapses. Rules. Rules were broken, ignored, and rewritten. Sometimes there were no rules. In fact, much of what we lived through was lawlessness. Yet, every part of our being is trained to support the rule of law. And maybe it was that lawlessness around us that helped us truly value the rule of law. As law students, we know that the most important part of the IRAC is the analysis. It is where many students struggle. It is where we gain or lose points. Sometimes, we challenge our professors on the points. We always wanted that extra point. The point today is that once we receive our bar cards, we are equipped as lawyers to analyze and address those societal issues in whatever ways we each decide to use our law degree. The point today is that in mere moments, we will receive our law degrees. That is the extra point we earned from our decision to attend and finish law school. So now the conclusion. We made it, and we are the future. We are the catalyst. Let's make sure that we have a seat at the table to be the voice of those who are often forgotten. Let's get into some good trouble. We can use our education and unique law school experiences to make our communities a better place. As one of our professors said, we strive for excellence or nothing at all. MLK reminded us that the arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends toward justice. Change takes a long time, but it does happen. Each of us who works for social change is part of the mosaic of all who work for justice. Together, we can accomplish multitudes. To the classes of 2020 and 2021, you rock. We rock. Congratulations to the graduates and our supporters who helped make our dreams a reality despite many challenges. So if you are a graduate or a supporter, stand up or give applause because we earned this JD together. Congratulations, everyone. Stay safe and healthy.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is my privilege to present to you the President and Dean of Western Michigan University, Thomas M. Cooley Law School, James McGrath, who will provide our welcome and introduce the commencement speaker.
Behind me.
Thank you so much. Well, welcome everyone. I have a few quick thank yous before I get started here. I want to thank, of course, our Master of Ceremonies, Karen Smithman, doing an excellent job so far. I expect it'll continue. And to our adjunct professor, Caroline Levine Johnson-Nee, for her invocation. Thank you very much, that was lovely. And of course, Talise Hunter for the inspiring farewell address. And of course, our singer of the national anthem, my goodness, who handed her a microphone? She had the voice that would reach all the way to Orlando. Very well done. Could we have another round of applause for her? Nicely done. So here we are, gathering together on September 11, 9/11. It's been 20 years since our nation was attacked, with people using our own planes packed with our fellow citizens to bring down buildings packed with more of our brothers and sisters. On one of those planes was a classmate of mine from the School of Public Health that I went to. Like your classmates here today, you're going to remember these people you're sitting with for a long time, and I'll remember my friend, especially his untimely ending. And on this 20th anniversary of these nefarious attacks, it's important to remember all of those whom we lost in the attacks and those who lost their lives trying to save them. Please join me in a moment of silence for all of these people. Thank you. September 11 is a day forever etched in our memory and a moment in history that changed our country and the world forever. Some changes were for the worst, some were a little more positive. Some of the changes were just annoying, like what it did to air travel, awful, right? But in a positive way, it changed the way our country values first responders, our police, our firefighters, our EMTs, who were on the scene of the attacks, selflessly stepped up in the aftermath of those attacks. We were reminded of the daily sacrifices they make, and I believe the country adopted a whole new level of respect for these amazing public servants. But not so positive. Not so positive was the way that many Americans started to look at our fellow Americans who may have Middle Eastern roots, or are Arab or Muslim. The renewed racism and xenophobia that followed the attacks threatened the progress we've made towards making ours a more perfect union. And this last year, we faced a new attack, this time by a microscopic enemy. And with it came additional changes. Many people started to work remotely, many court hearings were held via Zoom, and some of these changes will be permanent. COVID has forever changed the way we're going to do business. It's changed everything. COVID-19 and the resulting lockdown also created a moment in time when people said enough is enough of the systemic racism and demanded the promise of equality that all Americans deserve happen soon. Both the 9/11 attacks that happened 20 years ago and COVID have changed the world forever, but it's up to us to work to make these changes as positive, as fair, and as equitable as we can. Now, our graduates today are about to become lawyers, You will have earned special powers, and with that, commensurate responsibilities to serve. What an awesome privilege this is to be a member of this noble profession at this time of incredible uncertainty in the world. I can't tell you what to do to be a part of the positive change that our world needs, because all of us must find our own path that best suits our own journey. I only hope that we can respect and encourage each other as we work to positively shape the future. You might be saying, what is it, lawyers being the leaders? Well, lawyers as guardians of the rule of law is nothing new. You probably know of a quote by William Shakespeare from his play Henry VI, where someone says, "The first thing we do, let's kill all the lawyers." And that's not very positive, right? But it was made by a criminal, the character Dick the Butcher. And it's among Shakespeare's most famous lines, as well as one of the most controversial. As lawyer David Epstein argues, the quote is mistakenly thought to mean that Shakespeare was antagonistic towards lawyers, but no. Instead, he points out in an article in the Wall Street Journal that Shakespeare actually meant to portray lawyers as the guardians of the rule of law who stand in the way of a fanatical mob. So when Dick the Butcher said, "Let's kill all the lawyers," it was so he could disrupt the law and order so he could overthrow the government. So it's hardly a novel idea that lawyers are leaders to ensure a just society in times of significant change. And here we are. And as we face new crises, because there will be more, there will always be new challenges, we have an opportunity to learn from these past two decades. We need to fix what needs repair and build a shared understanding of equality, justice, and inclusion. Yeah, no pressure. Just get busy on that as soon as you can. Now, most of you know that because of the pandemic, all of our graduates here today left their classes on March 13th, 2020, and had no idea they'd never be going back to an in-person classroom. Law school became virtual for all of us. And this is the first time since January 2020 we're having a live graduation. Not quite back to normal. We have a few extra safety precautions, but we'll get the job done. Because that's what WMU Cooley grads do. You get the job done. So let's get this graduation done. Let me offer everyone a big hearty welcome to our amazing staff. Where are we? All over the place. Most working behind the scenes right now. An incredible faculty. Give me a little something for the faculty. His staff. Thanks. But of course, the reason why we're all here, welcome to our graduates of the Stanley Matthews class of 2021. And of course, we can't forget the family and friends of the Stanley Matthews class. I also want to offer you not just a welcome, but a special thank you to all of you who helped our graduates get through law school. Whether you're a family member, a friend, anyone in our graduate support system, you knew how committed our graduates are. And thank you for all the support. Maybe it was emotional. Maybe helping them learn. Maybe running flashcards with them. I don't know. Maybe even helping them out financially. Whatever you did, however you stood by our grads, I'd like to say thank you to the family and friends as well. And I'd also like to say, it's over. The lawyers know where I'm going. I'd like to say it's over, but it's not, right? You've got one big hurdle left. And the family and friends, I'm asking to stand by your grads for just a little longer as they get ready for the next challenge. And that's, of course, the bar exam, all right? But that's enough of that for now. I will bring this back later, but for now, let's just enjoy this special day, okay? Now it's my pleasure to introduce our keynote speaker, who is Judge Darryl Manning. Judge Darryl Manning was originally from Queens, New York. He's been a Hillsbury, yeah, give it up for Queens. He's been a Hillsbury County judge in Tampa, Florida since 2015. He presides over a drug court division and a unified family court division. Previously, he was a practicing and supervising attorney in the Tampa office of the Florida Attorney General for 16 years, where he appeared in state and federal trial and appellate courts. He earned his Juris Doctorate, the JD degree that our graduates are receiving today, from St. John's University School of Law in Queens, New York, and his Master of Laws from the Army Judge Advocate Legal Center and School at the University of Virginia in Charlottesville, Virginia. Judge Manning served as a judge advocate in the United States Army and served several tours in support of the global war on terrorism in Iraq, Afghanistan, Saudi Arabia, and Kuwait before retiring as a lieutenant colonel in 2015 after 30 years on active duty and in the reserves. Thank you for your service. You know, on Professor Hardrick's Journey to Esquire podcast, I learned that Judge Manning said he actually liked law school, so I'm just saying, he's a great guy. So, yeah, I know. Among his numerous positions since then, he's served as a prosecutor, a criminal defense attorney, and led a counterterrorism team consisting of law enforcement, SWAT, and intelligence agencies. Prior to becoming a JAG, Judge Manning was an artillery officer and fought in Operation Desert Storm. Yeah. Before graduating college at the University of South Carolina, he was an enlisted soldier working as a mechanic. He was awarded 2 Bronze Star medals for his meritorious service. Yeah. This man wanted to serve so badly that when he showed up at the recruiters, he was told he could not sign the contract because he was only 17 years old. He had to get his parents' permission, and of course, they gave it. And I hope I'm not stepping on anything you're going to say, Your Honor. He served as a member of both the National Conference of Bar Examiners and the Florida Board of Bar Examiners, where he served as chair from 2013 to 2015. Yeah. We're not going to ask him for any special favors with the bar, though. Okay. He served as a member of the Bar Grievance Committee in Hillsboro and is a certified guardian ad litem. Judge Manning has been a mentor in the Big Brother, Big Sister program for many years to a now teenager and serves on several boards in Tampa. As an adjunct law professor at WMU Cooley, he teaches criminal procedure, alternative dispute resolution, and military law. You are a very busy man, Your Honor. I'm glad you were able to take the time to come share some of your words of wisdom with us today. So everyone, please join me in welcoming Judge Darryl Manning.
Thank you so much for the introduction. When I heard Kimberly Lewis sing our national anthem, it took me back to my days in the military, wearing a uniform and wearing the flag on my shoulder. So proud of that. .846, .903, and .937. Of course, those are not random numbers that I just pulled out of a hat. Those are the exact times on September 11th, 2001, when terrorists hijacked our planes and flew them into the buildings. The World Trade Center, North Tower, the South Tower, and the Pentagon. A fourth plane, United Airlines 93, was also hijacked by terrorists. However, those passengers fought back and thwarted that attack. In essence, they changed the game. We're going to talk about that a little later, about changing the game. From the 13th Judicial Circuit, I bring warm greetings to our President and Dean McGrath, Dean Gustafson, wonderful faculty members, family and friends, and most of all, our graduates. It is truly my honor to stand here before you all today, not only as a judge in this county, but also an adjunct professor for many years of this school. As we have seen many commemorations and much discussion today, even on the dais, about this solemn day. I do want to acknowledge the accomplishments of the graduates that are before us. I want to talk about your future. And of course, I will touch on the importance of this day. Like some of you all, I have attended many graduations, and I've participated in a few. And so I know the speaker's usually the last thing before everyone gets the degree and goes off and has a great time. So I don't plan to stand here and put you all to sleep and keep you too long. But there are a couple of things that I do want to share with you this afternoon. So many of us have our own personal stories as it relates to 9/11. It's very similar to hearing those individuals speak about, where were you when John F. Kennedy was assassinated? Or where were you when Martin Luther King Jr. was assassinated? So where was I? I was in Tampa, about 10 miles from here, in the Hillsborough County Courthouse. I was prosecuting a case when the news started permeating the different courtrooms. Immediately, we were told to go ahead and pack up and return to our offices. As I did so and walked out the building, first thing I saw were the sharpshooters on the federal building, the roof of the federal building. I continued to walk down, and I saw additional sharpshooters on the roof of the Tampa Police Department. So if any of us thought at that time that it wasn't serious and it was only limited to New York or DC or that area, then we got an awakening by seeing those personnel on the rooftop waiting for the next attack. The first thing I thought when I did hear the news while we were in the courtroom hit me pretty hard. It was a visceral result or response that I had once I heard that the buildings had been attacked by the planes. Because when I was sitting in you all's seat, when I was a law student, I did an externship in the World Trade Center complex. I was there 3 days a week, and I knew the ins and outs of how to get there, the E-train, you go upstairs, you get on the elevator, you cross over and get the next elevator. So I knew that complex like the back of my hand. And to see the planes hit the towers just took me back in time to when I was there. This morning, I heard the remarks from former President George Bush. He spoke in Shanksville. Let me share with you some comments that he had made previously. He said, "Our conflicts that we engaged in would usually take place on remote lands, but this is a different kind of war. We felt protected by our oceans. This is a new reality for us." So those were his comments. So as you all sit there, you must be asking, what does that mean for us? Understand the history, understand it's historic. But what does that mean for us as graduates? Well, it means a tremendous deal for you all. As you heard President and Dean talk about, became a different world how we began operating. Many changes that we had to deal with. Our government had to take some extraordinary steps to keep us protected. The Department of Homeland Security was created. agencies such as the TSA were put in place. Some are not old enough, but others of us remember the ease in which you would pass through an airport, taking off your shoes, never did that. Always had the opportunity to walk down to the gate to meet loved ones on a holiday. It's prohibited now. Again, what does that mean for future lawyers? Well, aside from the inconveniences that I just mentioned, the rule of law becomes even more important now. Due process rights continue to be debated. The right to privacy seems to be evolving constantly. Where exactly is that line where government needs access to information to protect us versus an individual's right to privacy? Some would say, well, put it where the goats can get it. Make sure we understand what you're talking about. Many of us carry around smartphones, may have an Apple or Android, and so in the event that someone suspects that we've been engaged in some type of criminal activity and they want to get access to our phone and we refuse the authority from getting access to that, is it okay for them to go to Apple, for them to go to T-Mobile, for them to go to Verizon to simply get that access? Or do we have an inherent right to privacy? Where do you draw that line? That's where you all come into play. You all will be on the front lines, whichever side of the equation that you're on, but you will be on the front lines helping courts make the proper decision in terms of where is that line as it relates to safety for the community and privacy for the individual. Take a few minutes and talk with friends and family that have gathered here. It is tremendous to see the turnout here to support these graduates. They certainly didn't get here by themselves, as you heard the dean talk about. You all certainly were very instrumental in assisting them. So not to rain on the parade, but the step the dean was talking about that's coming up, the bar exam. Probably one of the most difficult exams in the country that they will face, regardless of which jurisdiction they're in. It'll be two grueling days. It's going to be a lot of preparation time. And so I know the graduates and you all want to enjoy this accomplishment, but please be mindful that those that will be taking the exam will need your support once again, whether it be the physical support, whether it be financial support, whether it be just giving them a respite so they can have some time to focus. If you take the kids out and take them to Chuck E. Cheese or to Chick-fil-A, just giving them that time, that quiet time to focus. And then once that happens, and as we know, they'll be successful and pass and get through the character and fitness portion, then we can call them attorneys. We can put Esquire behind their name. Don't do it right now. Okay. Except one or two more steps to go. The next thing I'm going to ask you all to do is just listen. Don't do anything. Just listen, and I'll talk to the graduates. I can only imagine the amount of support that you received from all those folks around you. Whether it be coming home and talking to them about a professor that called on you when you said, and you sent the email, I didn't get a chance to read today. Then you get called on anyway. So what better time to call on you all when you didn't read? Or if it was financial assistance that you received, or help with transportation, whether it be you or other family members, or just a shoulder to lean on or to cry on sometimes because things got a little rough. And we're not attending classes anymore in person. I've been fortunate enough to have many of you all in my class, whether it be in person or virtual, and had a chance to speak with some of you all today. So I understand many of the things that you were going through, but you had a great support network that I can see here. And so I asked them to just sit and listen, because I'm going to ask you all to express your gratitude to them right now in front of everyone with a round of applause for everything they've done for you all. Let's talk about the future. It is certainly easy in my shoes, and maybe in your shoes as well, to be pessimistic about our future, whether it be our country, or whether it be if you're going to be able to get a job, take care of those student loans, and just be able to enjoy all the hard work that you've put in. The days of uncertainty, because our COVID numbers seem to fluctuate up and down depending on when you look at the news. The endless debates and legal challenges over vaccines and masks. The perceived inequalities that individuals have with our justice system. And I can go on and on, where many people could be pessimistic. But as I stand here today, I share with you that I am optimistic about the way and the path forward for our country. And I see that is directly tied into you all's future. I was back in New York this summer, emerged from the subway station, and what did I see? I saw the Freedom Tower. I was there when the Freedom Tower was dedicated. What an awesome sight. It stands so tall where the Twin Towers used to be. On the military front, all our troops are back home from Iraq, minus about 2,000, and those will be back by the end of the year. All forces are back from Afghanistan. You may have an opinion on how that took place, but aside from that, all our forces are back from Afghanistan. We do have forces still deployed around the world. So our sons and daughters, mothers and fathers, brothers and sisters still are in harm's way. But as it stands now, we are in a relative period of stability. One might even say peace. We will constantly be vigilant as it relates to the global war on terrorism. But this is a relatively quiet period. For two decades, we have had no major terrorist attack on our homeland. If you can believe this, one of our founding fathers, Ben Franklin, on this day, on 9/11, certainly not recently, but back in 1773, stated, "There never was a good war or bad peace." There's nothing bad about peace. Again, why am I optimistic? As we look toward our criminal justice system, the exonerations that we hear about almost on a monthly basis, people that were wrongly convicted being released after 20 or 30 years in prison. And many thanks go to the Innocent Project and people at Cooley Law that worked on those projects. Tremendous, wonderful involvement. Things that you all can continue. Even in the midst of the pandemic, attorneys are back to work, strong as ever. I met up with a couple of graduates, Marvin Williams and Lenny Rodriguez. I saw them not too long ago. They graduated, passed the bar, and they formed a partnership. I had the privilege of swearing them both in once they were cleared for admission. And I saw them, and they said things are kicking on all cylinders, that they are doing some criminal work, they're doing some personal injury work, and they're getting referrals left and right. So, attorney work is busy. There was a change that was discussed in terms of going virtual. Most of the court hearings I have now are virtual, either by Zoom or Cisco WebEx or different other platforms. Well, you all are versed in that. You all have had virtual classes. So that's what's happening at the courthouse now. No different than what you've experienced. So if you get a court case and you need to handle it, you know what to do. Just go ahead and log in and sign on early and be ready to go when the judge takes the bench. For those reasons, my optimism is very high for our country and for our legal profession. We sit here today on the eve of 9/11, which will always be a solemn day of remembrance and reflection. It is a day that changed our country forever. You've heard the phrase, it's not whether you get knocked down, it's whether you get back up. And our country took a powerful blow, but yet we got back up. After today, not only will it be a solemn day for reflection and remembrance, but it will also be a day to recognize you all's accomplishments, with everyone here to witness that. So as I close, I'll share with you all something I'm going to do to commemorate today. I'm going to go out to Palm Harbor. It's about 30 miles from here. And they're going to have twin beams of light. So it's the only area in the Tampa Bay region that will be doing that. It'll be two twin beams of light to reflect the Twin Towers. And they're going to have that this evening from 8 to 10, if anybody else is interested in attending. Let me leave you with a couple of thoughts. First, I want to say again, congratulations to all our graduates. Tremendous accomplishments. They should not be understated. You all worked hard. I heard the address from the speaker saying that it's definitely memorable in law school history. You all will have stories upon stories to share with people down the road. Just imagine 20 years from now when you're talking to law classes and sharing with them what you all had to endure. Take some time to enjoy it. So, bar exam is coming, nothing you can do about that. Take some time to process what you've accomplished. In my class, I saw you all do some very hard work. I saw how dedicated you all were. So it wasn't given to you all. Take time to process it. Take time to enjoy it. A lot of times when we have these moments in our lives, weddings, graduations, we're such in a rush. Make sure our gowns and our hat look good. Get our heels right. Make sure you have the right suit. You know, make sure everybody else in the family is ready. Come on, let's go. You got to get there on time. So we're always rushing to do that and not taking a breather, taking a step back to enjoy the accomplishment. So go ahead and do that. Internalize what you've accomplished. For those of you all that will be preparing for the bar exam, prepare. Get ready. It's not going to be given to you. Not going to just sit there and watch a couple of videos. I think it's going to be fine. Everybody individually needs to find out what's going to work for them. But I subscribe to you that sitting back and putting on videos for 6 hours will not be enough. So do the work. Put the effort in. Because the results will show. Go ahead and join me in saying this, one and done. Let's say it, one and done. All right, commit that. One more quote that I'm going to share with you all. And I heard this from Denzel Washington. He said, "You'll never be criticized by someone who is doing more than you. You'll always be criticized by someone doing less." From here on out, not that it was an option, but it's no longer an option, if it was, about doing less. To whom much is given, much will be required. I had a chance to speak with a distinguished Cooley graduate by the name of Barbara Bachmeier. Found out the two of us happened to serve in the same area in Iraq in 2008. Unbeknownst to both of us. So she's an emergency care nurse and has a part-time legal practice, and she focuses on the elderly and on children. So she did ask me to share with you all to make sure you're engaged in the community. Pro bono hours are the key. It's time to give back. The ABA suggests 50 hours a year. She suggests doing much more. And so do I. When I sit in court, I see many families facing evictions. I see many children and the elderly that are voiceless in court. Access to justice is a problem here in Tampa, here in Florida, here in the country. You all can step in and reach. You all can make a difference. Share a personal note. A while back, I affiliated with a group of lawyers, and they were going to participate in a pro bono activity to providing legal services to some low-income individuals. So, of course, the dean was talking about me being involved in things. Well, I wanted to be involved in something else. So I said, I want to join you all. But Judge, you can't. You can't provide legal advice. That's true. As a sitting judge, I'm not able to provide any legal advice. But I said, I'm coming anyway. So we went down to Metropolitan Ministries over on Nebraska Avenue, and they had appointments set up for low-income individuals to come in and get some legal advice. It's about four or five attorneys, and it was from 6 p.m. to 9 p.m. And so I knew I couldn't provide any legal advice, so I picked up the clipboard, put the forms on there, and gave it to the next person that came in. Made sure it was complete, took the forms off the clipboard, gave it to the attorney and said, you have another client. And I did that so the attorneys didn't have to stop seeing clients and run the clipboard. I did that. Now, the people coming in had no idea who I was. I could have been a judge or I could have been the guy working down at 7-Eleven. They could care less. They just wanted their issue to get into the attorney so they could be seen. So that shows that all of us can do something. Doesn't matter what it is. All of us can do something and make a difference in those people's lives. So my challenge to you is to get involved, to give back, to join a local bar association, to join a section in the ABA, to mentor some young folks. This is something you can do. Again, such tremendous accomplishments. Pay it forward. Reach out to others and share everything that you have acquired with them. Going back to that Flight 93 that I talked to you about, with those courageous patriots, they did more. Flight 93 was destined for DC, maybe the Capitol, maybe the White House. And they had talked to their family and friends and found out that plane was on a suicide mission. That they weren't going to blow it up. That they weren't going to land in some airport safely and negotiate. It was a suicide mission. And those patriots banded together. And they did more. And so that's my charge to you all. Do more. Be a patriot and be a game changer just like those individuals on Flight 93. Godspeed to you all.
Thank you, Judge Manning. It is now my privilege to introduce Assistant Dean of the Tampa Bay campus, Kathy Gustafson, who will present the candidates for graduation.
Judge Manning, thank you very much for those very inspiring remarks. Ladies and gentlemen, in a few moments, the members of the graduating class will be receiving their degrees. This is an important and solemn occasion. We request that all persons in the assembly remain quiet during the ceremony until all degrees have been conferred. A professional photographer will be taking pictures of each graduate as they receive their diploma, and each graduate will receive a complimentary copy of his or her photo. Graduates from each of the law school's classes will be announced together, starting with the September 2021 graduates. The faculty of the Western Michigan University, Thomas M. Cooley Law School, has established criteria for the courses of instruction, the standards of achievement, and the period of residence necessary to ensure professional proficiency and practical scholarship in the law, and has also established the requirements for the degrees Juris Doctor and Master of Laws. The board has been advised that at the end of Trinity term 2021, 34 Juris Doctor students of the class known as the Stanley Matthews class were examined and were found to have fulfilled all of the requirements for those degrees. Now, therefore, it is resolved that the degrees are conferred and the candidates are presented to the president of Western Michigan University, Thomas M. Cooley Law School, will receive the degree of Master of Law or Juris Doctor at his hand. President and Dean McGrath, the faculty proudly presents the Juris Doctorate candidates. Starting with our September 2021 class, Sharif Al-Kalbani, magna cum laude. Rodney C. Mbwaze. Evelyn L. Dalmasay. Air Force veteran, Derek A. Eady, Sr. Camille Foster. Mishka Garcia. Rosalind Patrice Huff. Jonathan Raul Ibanez. Madeline James Sadonay. U.S. Army veteran Jim Johnson, magna cum laude. Veronica Kazanowski, cum laude. Jillian B. Lale. Elizabeth Rachel Larish. Shaquan Lewis, cum laude. Danielle Marie Monroe, cum laude. Baron Olden, Jr. David Joseph Papa. Austin Parker. Anna P. Pinzon, cum laude. Sandra Renee. Rainey Nancy Seshi, cum laude. U.S. Army veteran LaVon Shepherd. Woo! Joey M. Skelly, magna cum laude. Lakeisha Sabrina Thomas. Lizette Toccato. Khadijah Rochelle Tucker. U.S. Army veteran Abdul Wahab. Now we will continue with our class of May of 2020. Genesis Quintana. Alan Silva. Tiffany Young, cum laude. Now we will move on to our class of January 2021. Deja Craig, cum laude. Lisa Manini. We're now moving on to our class of May of 2021. Kadesia Barber. Kadesia Barber. Brianna Coleman, cum laude. Carla Key. Stephanie Lorenas, cum laude. Sandeep Singh, cum laude. Deani Stewart. And from our Lansing campus, May of 2021, Natasha Lopez Perez, magna cum laude. Africa Courtney James. Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you the graduates of the Stanley Matthews class.
Thank you. You may be seated. Please help me welcome back once again our president and Dean McGrath, who will now give us his closing remarks. Thank
you. All right. Thank you. Graduates, congratulations once again on this very significant milestone. You know, when things get tough, I'm going to ask you to remember what brought you to law school to begin with. Most people come to law school with a sense of purpose. Maybe you want to change the world. Maybe just change your life, help your family. Whatever it was that brought you here, remember that. Let it give you that passion, rekindle that passion to get you through the tough times. And hopefully we haven't completely beat that passion out of you in law school. Anyway, you're going to see many challenges as a lawyer. And as you know, I'm so glad the judge also brought it up. We've got one big challenge ahead of us still, right? And one thing I want you to remember as you prepare for the bar exam is that your mindset really is important. You have to have a very positive mindset about this. You could just say, all right, I just graduated from law school and now I have to take the bar exam. Or you could say, I just graduated from law school and now I get to take the bar exam. And you do, it's a privilege. Not everybody does. Not everybody even graduates from high school, but you did. Not everybody gets to go to college, you certainly did. Hardly anybody gets to go to law school, you did. And even fewer of those people graduate, but you just did. So you can do this. And so your mindset's really important. You have to know you can do it. It's a great privilege to sit for the bar exam. So it's a privilege best enjoyed only once, though. So do your best this time, because you've earned this chance. And I'm convinced every one of you can do it. And remember, all this hard work you're going to be doing is not just for yourself, but for your colleagues as well. When we all do better, when each one of us do better, we all do better. So do the best you can. Do it for your family and for your future clients who deserve your representation. In closing, I want to once again thank everyone for sharing in our graduate celebration of their incredible achievement. And graduates, although you're finishing up an important chapter in your life as a WMU Cooley student, the book is not quite finished. We will be ready to share in your successes and any setbacks you may encounter as you become great lawyers and leaders. So stay in touch, become an active member of our Alumni Association. Stand tall with over 20,000 WMU Cooley alums and continue to make us all proud of you. And now I'm going to hand it back to our Master of Ceremonies, Karen. Take us all home.
This concludes our commencement ceremony for the Stanley Matthews class. Thank you to all of you for joining us today. We ask that all guests remain seated until the members of the academic process depart. Thank you again.